We've been talking about the Spartans so far in our series on the warrior archetype, and I think maybe today it's a good idea to switch over to the Athenians to give us the other side. The Athens and Sparta were like the yin and the yang of the ancient Greek world. Everything that Sparta was, Athens wasn't, and everything that Athens was, Sparta wasn't. So I want to talk about them today because they really are another part of the warrior archetype, of that whole concept that I think as we go farther and we start to talk about the inner war, this is really going to have a real bearing on it. Now, there was another battle 10 years before the Battle of Thermopylae, and another famous battle where the Persians, it was really the equivalent of the First World War as opposed to the Second World War, where the Persians invaded. And this was the Battle of Marathon. The famous thing that was 26.2 miles from Athens, where the Persians invaded, landed on the plain of Marathon, and the Athenians faced them in armor and threw them back into the sea. So a great victory for the Athenians. The Spartans actually arrived a day late, to their great shame and consternation. They were held up by a religious festival, and all they could do was sort of gawk around the battlefield at this great victory that their rivals, the Athenians, had won. And just to give you a little bit of a sense of it, the great playwright Aeschylus, probably until Shakespeare, the greatest playwright ever, fought in this battle as a young man, as an armored infantryman. And when he wrote his own epitaph toward the end of his life, he didn't mention any of his plays or anything that he had done as a citizen. He just talked about his courage at Marathon, and his epitaph was, "Here lies Aeschylus the Athenian, of his courage at the plain of Marathon, the long-haired Persian could speak much." So Marathon was a great, great victory for the Athenians. And here is what I want to read today to contrast the difference between Athens and Sparta, is from Pericles' funeral oration, one of the great speeches of all time, coming from Thucydides' History of the Peloponnesian War. Now, every year at Athens, it was kind of like our Memorial Day. They would go out, the entire city would go out to the place where everyone was buried, and a particularly illustrious citizen would be picked, and he would give a speech in praise of those young men who had given their lives for Athens. And it became a speech really about in praise of the city and in praise of the Athenian way of life. And in this particular speech, Pericles, who was the greatest, presided over the Golden Age, the building of the Parthenon, et cetera, he contrasts Athens and Sparta. So this will give us a real good insight in it. Then there is a great difference between us and our opponents, meaning the Spartans, in our attitude towards military security. Our city is open to the world, and we have no periodic deportations like the Spartans do, in order to prevent people from observing or finding out secrets of what we rely upon. There is this difference, too, in our educational system. Here he's talking about the agoge. The Spartans, from their earliest boyhood, are submitted to the most laborious training and courage. We pass our lives without all these restrictions, and yet are just as ready to face the same dangers as they are. Now, I want to talk just a little bit for a second about the Athenian belief that a citizen had to participate in the life of his city. They had a law in Athens that if there was a revolution and you tried to sit it out as an individual, you kind of sat on the fence, when the revolution was over, you were fined because they wanted you to participate, to take sides. And there is a word in Greek for someone, a citizen who does not participate in the debate and the politics of his city, and the word is idiotes. So that kind of speaks for itself. Now here I'm coming to what I think is one of the seminal sentences in literature or in history as it relates all the way down to our time. This is Pericles talking about the character of the Athenian people and of Athenian citizens. "Our love of what is beautiful does not lead to extravagance. Our love of the things of the mind does not make us soft. And he talks about how the freedom of the city makes for strong individuals. And here he comes. Taking everything together, then, I declare that our city is an education to Greece. And I declare that, in my opinion, each single one of our citizens, in all the manifold aspects of life, is able to show himself the rightful lord and owner of his own person, and to do this, moreover, with exceptional grace and exceptional versatility. Now, the phrase here to me is the rightful lord and owner of his own person. If you think about this, if you think about what this had never happened in history before, the great civilizations coming before Athens were Egypt with the pyramids and all of that sort of stuff, and Babylonian civilization, Persian civilization, and all of those, the people were ruled by a despot, by a tyrant, who either was God or the equivalent of God. And so an individual was actually the property of somebody who was above him. You could be murdered, your property could be taken away from you, your wife, your children could be taken away from you. Or otherwise you might be a slave or a serf or in vassalage or bondage. Or even if you were in a wild tribe, if you were a tribesman, although your tribe had freedom, you yourself were bound within the code of the tribe, just like they are in Afghanistan and Pashtunistan today. So this concept in Athens, where it really came to its fore, the concept of the citizen, the free individual who was the rightful owner of his own person, that's an incredible breakthrough. I mean, it's what we as Americans live by. That's our highest ideal. And I think when it comes down to the higher levels of the warrior archetype, that's where we're trying to get to. Not someone who is blindly obedient to some authority, but someone who is an individual capable of assessing a situation and making a decision based on his own, you know, considerations of what's right and what's wrong. So this is going to take us. We're going to do another video about the Athenians, further talking about their characteristics. But this premise of a person being the rightful owner of his own person is a critical thing to me in history and in what we're talking about here in the warrior archetype.